this video, we'll look at the basics of running simple channel simulations using IBIS-AMI models. This video will focus primarily on the practical aspects of running a channel simulation, rather than an in-depth look at how it runs. If you haven't already changed your ADS settings to the HSD personality, you should do so. On the main window, go to Help, Design Flow Settings, and select High Speed Digital. You'll then have the option to retain your hotkeys and select add-ons. After going through the process of changing your design flow, you will need to restart ADS to have the changes reflected in the program. We'll first run a simulation using behavioral models for the TX and RX which are shipped with ADS. Following that, we'll replace the transmitter with an IBIS-AMI model. Note that you can mix and match IBIS-AMI and behavioral models in the same simulation if, for example, you only had access to the IBIS-AMI model for the transmitter. We'll navigate to the simulation channel sim palette and place the differential TX. Let's set up the settings for the transmitter. The first tab is PRBS, or pseudo-random binary sequence. We can set the transmission rate, the high voltage, the low voltage, and the rise and fall time of a bit. We can also set the encoding type of the data. For this simulation, we'll choose 8B10B, which will map 8 bits of data to 10 bits of data, allowing for better clock recovery. For now, we won't equalize from the transmitter. Change the equalization method to none. To have a more realistic simulation, we'll also add some jitter to the transmitter. I'll specify the DCD jitter and its probability function. We also need a receiver. Place the diff RX component from the palette. The receiver is able to set the equalization types. I'll add FFE and DFE to the receiver. We also need to make sure that the receiver has a load. I'll uncheck exclude load and leave the load at 100 ohms. This will prevent clutter on the schematic by internally setting up a load in the receiver. We've now set up a transmitter and receiver for the simulation. We'll now create the channel that the signal will be transmitted on. To do so, we'll have to create a substrate and a line model. Let's start with the substrate. Navigate to the controlled impedance line designer from the toolbar, then create a new substrate. We can use one of the default substrate settings for this simulation. I'll select the 4-layer board. At this point, I can edit the dielectric and conductive materials, thicknesses, and layers. Once you've changed the settings of your substrate to what you'd like, press Save. Back in the controlled impedance line designer, we need to set the type of line model we're defining. We'll select an edge-coupled strip line. As you can see, we can change the layers of the top plane, bottom plane, and the signal to any of the layers that were on the substrate. Let's set some initial values for the coupled line. We'll do analysis on the Nyquist frequency of 4 GHz. We'll simulate for this for a 15-inch line with a width of 10 mils and a spacing of 15 mils. Once done, press Simulate. We can see that the differential impedance is about 89.5. We want to design this line to have 100 ohm to match the impedance from the receiver. To optimize the values of width and spacing to have a 100 ohm differential, we'll go to the Optimize menu. Change the goal to ZC differential and the value to 100. Then select the variable to optimize. I'll select width. We're now done computing the values of our line model. Save your line by clicking on the Add Line Type icon, then press OK. Now that we have a line model, we need to place a component that will use it. Go to the T Lines Line Type palette and place a two-port line. Double-click on the channel and select the line type that we just made. We'll also change the length of the channel to be 15 inches. We'll take eye measurements from before and after the equalization in the receiver and before the transmission line. Go back to the channel sim palette and place the differential eye probes. We'll wire up the probes. Then we'll take a single-ended eye probe and put it on the output of the receiver. You can add which measurements to take in the eye probe in its settings. To make the familiar eye diagram, we only need the density measurement, but I'll also go ahead and add the BER contours, waveform, and the voltage and current bathtubs. Finally, we need to add the channel simulation controller. From the same palette, place it on the schematic. We can run a bit-by-bit or statistical simulation. I'll leave it at bit-by-bit, but I'll simulate 1E6 bits instead of 1,000. We can now run the simulation. To save time, I've added the plots in advance. However, we'll take some time now to investigate what is being plotted. The density plot will be present in nearly all of your data displays. As you can see, I've added the density from the eye probe. Overlaid on the density is the BER contour. Two bathtubs have also been generated. Below, we see the timing bathtub. On the right is the voltage bathtub. If you want to show the plot transposed as I've done here, you'll have to write an equation for calculating the transpose. In the top right, we see the graphs for the signal before the channel. The bottom left shows us before equalization graphs, and the bottom right shows us after equalization graphs. This way, we can observe the degradation of the signal over the channel, then how the equalization in the receiver helps to clean up the eye diagram. We'll now move on to using IBIS-AMI models for this simulation. Before we load the IBIS-AMI files, I want to quickly point out the location of the files in my file system. You can load the models from anywhere in your file system, but I recommend placing them in the data folder of your workspace, as I've done here. This is the default location of models loaded and will shorten file names on your schematic. Let's get rid of the old TX. Now from the channel sim palette, we'll place the AMI model TX. Double-click on the TX and navigate to your IBIS-AMI file in your file space. Under the PRBS tab, we'll again set the data rate to 8 gigabits per second. Under the encoder tab, again, we'll set it to 8B10B. We now need to set up some of the AMI parameters. We'll specify the filter by pre-shoot and de-emphasis. We'll then specify that pre-shoot and de-emphasis to 1.9, 0. This particular PCI3 model has SSC, or spread spectrum clocking. I don't want SSC for this simulation, so I'll turn it off. We'll then set the SSC amplitude to be user-defined at 0, and the SSC frequency also to be defined at 0. These settings will be enough for the TX-AMI model for this simulation. We'll now simulate. With the waveform plots, we can see how the pre-shoot affects the bitstream waveform, as well as how it is attenuated over the channel, and then how the equalization helps to create a flatter response. From this point, you can further tweak the parameters of the TX and channel to see how that affects the eye diagrams. ADS works with a mix of IBIS-AMI and behavioral models, but generally speaking, the receiver is also usually an IBIS-AMI model. This simple channel simulation contains all of the parts you'd expect to see in a larger channel simulation. We have a transmitter with a set of properties, which sends a signal through a channel. The channel has physical properties that will degrade the signal. This signal is then picked up by the receiver, which will perform equalization. Since this is a simulation, the eye probes have no effect on the signal, so we take measurements over a number of points in the simulation. In this particular schematic, we can see the original signal, the signal after it passes through the channel, and then after it has been equalized. These plots give us an understanding of what happens to the signal as it goes through the channel. Thank you for watching this Keysight ESOF EDA tutorial. You can find a link to a free trial of ADS in the video description below.